Well, thank you very much for that lovely introduction. And thank you for the chance to be here and talk about some of this work. I was never a very obedient student, and this may be just another occasion when I step over the traces here or something. I would prefer if we could have questions as we go along, at least for some questions. In other words, just interrupt me. You'll soon see that you won't be interrupting a polished, memorized presentation or anything of the sort. This is, as much as anything, a kind of working session. I don't make presentations for a living. I do the work out there for a living. And what you're seeing is an effort to kind of put together the information about, well, what we've done and what other people have done around us. You know, I have various bits of paper that I've written some notes on. So it may be a bit rough. So I've got a PowerPoint, there's pictures. You know, if I'm not clear enough in what I say, look at the pictures. Makes it a little more entertaining anyway. I'm going to be sipping on hot water because it helps my still kind of froggy throat. But what else can I say? Let's see. The Indian Law Resource Center, that's my organization. We're a small nonprofit. We are based in Helena, Montana. We also have an office in Washington, D.C. We've been around for 30-some-odd years. We're small, and one reason for that is that we don't accept any government funding except from tribal governments, Indians. But we feel that funding from governments can be compromising. In other words, it might impair our work for our clients, who are Indian tribes, Indian nations, indigenous peoples. We work throughout the Americas, by the way, not just in the United States. We are funded mainly by private foundations, you know, the usual suspects like the Ford Foundation, and a lot of individuals. Tribes also make contributions when they can, but mostly, of course, we work for tribes that couldn't afford to pay for the kind of legal work we do. So we've remained small. There are about 5 or 6 lawyers, depending on how you count. That once in a while there are a few more than that, and sometimes there are fewer. But that's about how it goes. What I'm going to be talking about is what American Indian nations, Indians and indigenous peoples from elsewhere in the world, have been doing in the United Nations and in other international fora over the last, well, roughly 40 years. A lot has happened, much has been done. The significant thing about it, in a nutshell, is that that work at the international level has been genuinely and actually transforming the relationship between indigenous peoples and the countries where they live, transforming the way indigenous peoples are actually treated by countries where they are located. By now, indigenous peoples and indigenous organizations have taken a place in the international community in places like the United Nations. They're widely accepted there. Some countries grumble about it. They may not like it, or they wish we weren't there. But in general, indigenous peoples are an accepted part of the international community. Exactly what that means for the present and what it means for the future is something that we can talk about a little bit more at the end. It will make more sense after you've seen what has taken place. Let me see what I have to do to get this going again. We have to look at the baseball a little bit. Okay. We'll get the PowerPoint up. Let me get it so that it fills the screen sort of. There we go. The Indian Law Resource Center is what's discussed there. We needn't dwell on that. I've already talked about it. If you feel so inclined, send in a contribution. It's always very helpful. Well, I'm serious, but of course that's not why we're here. This wasn't meant to be a fundraiser. I'm going to tell you about some people that went to the United Nations, indigenous leaders who went to the United Nations before we did. There were others that came along earlier, but when we began, here's what we were thinking about. This was the 1970s. Things were not very good. We had a situation in the United States where the United States government and the Bureau of Indian Affairs were about as paternalistic and manipulative as you can imagine. It's changed a lot since then. But at that time, tribal governments were generally much under the control of the Bureau of Indian Affairs. Indian resources, money, and all else were firmly in the control of the federal government, regardless of what the law might be. We had then, and we still have now, laws in the United States that permit Congress to do virtually anything to Indian tribes and to take virtually any action they wish with regard to Indian resources. Congress can simply confiscate the land that belongs to an Indian tribe, and by that I mean simply take it away without paying for it and for no legal purpose at all. And they do it. Congress has the authority to simply take the money that belongs to an Indian tribe that's held in the U.S. Treasury and keep it, or give it to others. And they don't have to pay for it, and there is nothing the tribe can do about it. The Supreme Court has said Congress can do anything it wants to with an Indian tribe and all its property. Nothing since slavery has been really that outrageous in U.S. law, but that is the law today, and it was the law then in the 1970s. Yes?
And when did the Supreme Court rule that?
Well, it had many rulings, but one of the worst ones was exactly the same year and the same Supreme Court that decided the great desegregation case, Brown versus Board of Education, that desegregated the school systems in the United States. That same Supreme Court decided unanimously what I just said, namely that the Supreme Court can take Indian land without due process and without payment, that the United States Congress has plenary authority over tribes, and so on. But there have been other decisions that have echoed that and added to it, and so on. So that was 1954, I'm sorry. 1954. These are not old, crusty, well, that's pretty old, but we're not talking about 1800s or 1700s. This is relatively modern stuff. It's existing law, it's fresh. They still use it. The Justice Department has no compunction whatever about making these arguments. Last time I was in court, they went in and told the appeals court in Washington, D.C. that the Interior Department had the absolute authority to simply displace, do away with the tribal government that I was representing and replace it with a different tribal government, arbitrarily, without the tribe itself voting on it, without the tribe itself having any say in it whatsoever. And our lawsuit against the United States government was summarily dismissed. You know, that kind of thing can't happen to anybody else in the United States today. It would violate the United States Constitution. And in my opinion, it violates the United States Constitution when it happens to Indian tribes. But the Supreme Court has never said so. And as I say, the Justice Department, even this administration, uses these legal doctrines freely. That was the Obama administration who did that, what I just described in court. I don't think Obama knew about it, mind you. Anybody, yes?
But what is like the legal reasoning that they don't have the right of possession?
Oh, the Supreme Court in that 1954 case said every schoolboy knows that when we came on this continent, we conquered the savages who lived here. Well, A, that isn't true. And B, even if it were true, that is not a legal reason for denying them rights today. I mean, the Sioux were winning when the treaties were made with the Sioux. They were winning. They were not conquered. So, well, anyway, that's the kind of so-called reasoning that's behind these things. There really isn't reasoning. They're racist, stupid decisions. You would be shocked to read them. You know, I'm always suspicious when I hear people say things like I'm saying right now. I always think it must be an exaggeration. It probably isn't true. I know what it sounds like, but I also am unwilling to gloss it over and tell you something less than the truth. Go look for yourself. The case I'm talking about, the fun one to read, I mean, it's nauseating, but the fun one is called Tehiton Indians, T-E-E-H-I-T-T-O-N, it's hyphenated, Tehiton Indians. You can Google it, the case will pop up. Tehiton Indians versus the United States. It's a shocking decision to read. That's the leading one. There are others. Anyway, that's what we were faced with. I was, you know, right at that time, I went to the Interior Department with a group of Oneida Nation leaders because the Oneida Nation had serious claims for land that was their land, that was taken from them unlawfully in violation of federal law. Well, the top lawyer for the Interior Department, it was the solicitor for the Interior Department, his name was Leo Krulix, and this was under the Carter administration. He told the Oneida leaders, either you negotiate a settlement to these land claims and do it quick, or we'll ask Congress to simply extinguish these claims and you'll get nothing. I was there. I saw him. He said it in front of me. He said it to the Oneida leaders. You can't say that to anyone else in the United States. No one with a legal claim can have their claim extinguished by Congress without just compensation. That's the Fifth Amendment. But Leo Krulix, the top lawyer for the Interior Department in the 1970s, was very free with that kind of threat. He knew what the law was, and he was not afraid to use it to, you know, to intimidate the Oneida Nation. They didn't fall for it. Actually, Congress didn't have to extinguish the claim. The U.S. Supreme Court did. But let's not go into that. That's what was going on in the 1970s. You know, I'm never going to get through this if I keep going on so much. But the denial of rights to tribes and the lack of remedies in the United States was what compelled us to start this work in the 1970s. there's more that could be said. massacres were relatively commonplace. I say relatively. They happened every year, usually several times a year in Central and South America, and elsewhere in the world for that matter. That is, killings of fairly large numbers of Indians by government people. They were pretty common back then. In Paraguay at that time, shooting Indians was nothing. If you owned the land, you could shoot the Indians if you wanted to. That was commonplace, impunity, you wouldn't be punished for it. Dangerous place to live if you're Indian. So that's what we were looking at in the 1970s, and we thought we needed to do something different, so we thought we'd give it a try and see about the United Nations. we thought it would be useful, not just to get a nice piece of paper that said nice things, but if we could improve the legal framework, it should improve economic opportunity. It should make life better on reservations in Indian country. It would save lives in Central and South America, and so on. These were some of the things on our minds. People belittled us for thinking of going to the United Nations. They said it would never work. You can't do that. And when I found this Gary Larson cartoon, this is what we felt like, you know. People said we couldn't do it, but we could. We could. The caption says, hey, they're lighting their arrows. Can they do that? Well, people acted that way toward us. And the answer is, yes, we could do that, and lots more. This guy, Chief Descaje, famous fellow, he went to the League of Nations to try to speak in 1923. He was really a chief. Now that's a plane's headdress, you probably know. And he was Cuba. Descaje is one of the titles of for a Cuba chief in the Six Nations Confederacy. His real name was Levi General. Lived in Canada. I should say that's his English name. Descaje was his title. When we arrived in Geneva in 1977, the mayor of Geneva held a reception for us because the mayor of Geneva remembered Descaje from when the mayor was a boy and met Descaje. A remarkable thing, Descaje was well known in Geneva, even though in fact he was never allowed to speak to the United Nations. This man, Maori from Aotearoa or New Zealand, also went there, but again without notable success. Most of these people did their work, died unsung. I knew this man, Matt Bear Anderson, Tuscarora, also from New York State. He and Buffalo Tiger, Nick Suki, leader in Florida, and Fidel Castro put together an agreement entitled the Buckskin Treaty and took it to the United Nations in about early 60s, very early. Might have been even late 50s. It didn't work. Adair died a frustrated man. That's a photo of the delegates marching into the Palais des Nations in Geneva in 1977. There are many more behind them. There were 100 to 150 indigenous representatives from the Americas. That conference was only for the Americas. All of those people are deceased that you see there. But it doesn't matter. What they did has lived on. Thomas Banyakya spoke to the General Assembly 1992, probably the first indigenous man to do that. He always interpreted the Hopi prophecy and nothing less. And I told them he would do that, but they asked him to speak to the General Assembly anyway. I thought they were going to have to drag him off because he wouldn't. His instructions were to tell the world about the Hopi prophecy, and it's a bit long. Anyway, that's what it looked like in the 1977 conference. That's the Six Nations delegation. I was doing the legal work for the Haudenosaunee Six Nations. The room was filled with all kinds of people from all over the Americas.
Can I just ask,
sure,
how is it that you blended so that tribes from all over the Americas would be in contact with one another and decide who would represent them and how they would come as?
Good question. It worked, however. We called and wrote to people that we knew. There was no email or internet, of course. But that still doesn't explain it. We talked a lot about what we hoped to do. The draft declaration existed, and we circulated it by mail and at some conferences. So many of the delegates already knew that our hope was to initiate this draft declaration with the idea that the UN would adopt a draft declaration. But still, really, we arrived in Geneva never having met together before. And everybody marveled that we all got along, that we all seemed to have the same ideas, we all seemed to be of one mind about what we needed to do there. It was kind of unusual because, although we spent a year, year and a half organizing that conference, but that didn't explain it because it was not a set up deal. We didn't really know what was going to happen. That's Liam Shenandoah, he was the Taradaho of the Iroquois Confederacy. He's on the right, you know. Oneida, sub-chief to his left. Some other people there, that guy on the left was a friend of mine. The work in the UN progressed. We asked that the United Nations create a working group to do something about a draft declaration on the rights of indigenous peoples. That took a little over 5 years to do. We had to keep going there. Delegations of Indian leaders would go there and make statements, oral statements. We'd make written statements. We would keep lobbying countries to explain why it was so important. And slowly, slowly, it came to pass that a working group was created to develop the declaration. Eventually, in later years, near the time that the declaration was getting ready for adoption, now, the working group really began in earnest around 1985 and didn't wrap up until 2006. I mean, those negotiations didn't finish. So there was an enormous period of time. Toward the end, that's what a working group meeting looked like. That's just a part of the room. There are 200 or 300 people in that room, but that's the Navajo Nation delegation. And that friend of mine now has white hair sitting up there. But that's what the meetings looked like. You notice the Navajos all have laptop computers sitting there, working on the text of the declaration, as compared to these guys in the 1970s with pen and paper. They didn't wear buckskin except for show. That's another shot of the working group, just so you have some idea what's going on there. That process of developing the UN Declaration, it got to be so huge that as many as 400, 500, 600, 900 indigenous people would show up for a working group meeting. It would be enormous. Nothing like that had ever happened in the United Nations before. No human rights process had ever actually involved the victims of the human rights violations. And we got the United Nations to agree that we could participate without having any special credentials. Now, my organization has status as a non-governmental organization. We had to go through a lot of red tape and political nonsense to get that. So we have the status, but most people can't possibly go through that. But the UN Working Group decided it was all right for indigenous leaders to come and participate, even without having NGO status. And so hundreds and hundreds of people would come, and over the years, thousands, I mean cumulatively, thousands of indigenous peoples made their way to Geneva to participate in these efforts. So it was a big deal, and no one can take very much personal credit for what happened, because it was a global effort. It went far beyond the Americas. Everybody showed up, including fakers, you know, people who weren't indigenous at all. Never mind. Well, if there's no credentials, I mean, if you can say your name, you could get in. So it was kind of wild, but we got her done. I hope I'm not skipping over. This is just a stock photo of the UN General Assembly. They finally voted on it in 2007 and adopted it. Overwhelmingly, there were 4 votes against it. Here's a summary. 143 countries voted in favor, 4 against, including the United States. Notice there's quite a few missing. That was disappointing. They just weren't there. All those countries, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, and the United States, changed their minds because we kept working on it. I say we, I mean, indigenous people in those countries did it and persuaded their governments to change their minds and come out in support of the declaration. So what that means now is that there is no country in the world that opposes that declaration. And in UN lingo, we say there is a worldwide consensus about the Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. Don't worry, I'm going to tell you about the declaration and what's in it. I realize this is a little go ahead.
Sorry, I didn't understand about the because there was this country that are, you know, affected directly, so they opposed it after they changed their mind, or what did you say?
They did change their mind.
So today they agreed.
Okay. Australia, New Zealand, United States, and Canada, they all support the declaration today.
Were they pressured?
Of course. Oh, yes. Yeah, we worked very hard on that. In the United States, and I'm sure they worked just as hard in the other countries as well. Canada still has its fingers crossed. They say, well, we support it, sort of. But officially, they support it. So there's the total. There are 193 member nations in the UN, so you can see there's some missing. Let's keep moving on. I'm rattling on too much. What's in there? Well, there's the right of self-determination. I'll show you the text in a moment. Something that maybe you wouldn't think is important, but the right to exist as distinct peoples, nations, and tribes, that right was not there before. If countries wanted to put them out of existence or refuse to recognize them, they could. In fact, that's still the law in the United States. The United States claims that it can terminate tribes anytime it wants. Now that they've agreed to the declaration, they're at least morally obligated not to do it. We didn't explain that carefully to the United States. But in all fairness, we should have. There's a right to be free from forced assimilation, right to exercise cultural, religious, and spiritual rights. Many, many rights are dealt with. Rights to education, rights relating to labor, rights relating to radio stations and media. Almost everything you can think of is in there. Let's look at a few things, and I'm going to have to go quickly or I won't get through. This is one of the more eloquent articles. Enough? This is the right of self-determination. It's the same language used in the Covenant on Civil and Political Rights and the Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, describing the right of self-determination generally. The difference being, by the way, the covenants, the right of self-determination prior to this declaration, only applied to peoples of whole peoples of a country or a colonized territory. Did not apply to distinct peoples within the boundaries of an existing country. No such group had a right of self-determination. It was a gap in international law. It was not a very good thing. It was recognized as a failure of international law. But this article establishing that indigenous peoples as distinct peoples within a country had their own distinct right to govern themselves, to decide on their own political status. That was a first. Indigenous peoples achieved that, and I hope others do as well. One aspect of the right is the right to self-governance, the right to autonomy. Notice it's limited to their internal and local affairs, but it actually doesn't say limited to, does it? The right is rather open-ended, and I believe that proper interpretation is that the right of self-determination goes beyond the mere right to govern local and internal affairs. You can participate in the political and social life of the country as a whole, if they want to as well. Look at a few other things. Notice collective rights. Here's the right to exist, by the way. Have the collective right to live in peace and freedom and security as distinct peoples. Another one. I'm sorry. Just look at the big title up at the top and we can come back to it. You know, you can Google on Declaration on Rights of Indigenous Peoples and get the whole text. Easy as pie. It pops right up. So it's a rather long thing. It has 40-odd articles. Women are protected. Youth, children, and so on. Land rights. This was a big one. No forced removal. That was a biggie. But skip this. This is a mistake. It's a mistranslation, but this is the key thing. Indigenous peoples have the right to own, use, develop, and control the lands, territories, and resources they possess. If you ask the Bureau of Indian Affairs or the Department of Interior, they say, well, no, not exactly. That land is held in trust by the United States. The United States is actually the owner and has the authority to control the land. Well, that's what we're trying to deal with. This says the indigenous peoples have the right to own their own land, to actually own it, and not be treated like Well, you know, in the United States, if you're incapacitated mentally, or if you're a child, you can be treated this way. Your property will be held in trust and somebody else will manage it. Apart from that, you have the right to own and control your own property. Except if you're an Indian tribe. Then the Interior Department will do it for you.
So anyway, when you were lobbying with the Obama administration to sign on to the Universal Declaration, was that the sticking point?
No. No. You know, interestingly, they ignored the hard stuff. They were worried about strange things like how will this apply in Guam, and odd things. They were concerned about, things like the rest of the world doesn't have the First Amendment the way we do here, freedom of speech, and so there's some things they were worried about might infringe on freedom of speech. Odds and ends. They didn't seem to worry about the big stuff. They swallowed the big stuff. Actually, they had agreed to it in the UN negotiations. Well, Indigenous women have been using the Declaration to fight against violence. They do that both in the UN and in the Organization of American States. People have been using it to educate and lobby Congress, to work on economic development issues, land claim issues. People have found a lot of clever ways to use the Declaration, even though the Declaration isn't, strictly speaking, binding on the United States. Well, let me say that Indigenous peoples, before we get to the World Conference, working on the Declaration wasn't the only thing we did. A lot of stuff was going on at the same time. We were making statements in the United Nations Human Rights Council, in the, it was then called the Subcommission on Prevention of Discrimination and Promotion of Human Rights. It had several names, but we would make statements, written statements, oral statements. We would bring in Indian leaders who would speak under our credentials and so on. We worked on reports. There was a huge land rights study that the subcommission did that we contributed to. Fact is, Indigenous peoples practically wrote the thing for the UN. There was a later study on the right to subsurface resources, a very big issue, especially in Central and South America. Again, we generated that study and saw it through to conclusion. There were lots of expert meetings that the UN convened, meetings about land rights, about self-determination, and lots of other issues. There were cases and complaints that were submitted, specific cases, such as about the Western Shoshone land rights, the Dam Sisters, you may have heard of them, or there was the case of the Miskito Indians in Nicaragua when they had literally a civil war with the Sandinista regime in the 1980s. There was a case about that. There was the Yanomami case where the Yanomami Indians in Brazil were being invaded and began dying in large numbers as a result of violence and disease and mercury poisoning and so on. There were many such cases both in the UN and the Organization of American States. Indian people would file these cases, argue them, make statements about them, and use them to build understanding, to build support, to get the world on our side. I guess it's the simplest way to sum it up. A lot was done. Lots of Indian leaders. There were people from, well, all over. Many tribes in the United States did this, particularly Sioux tribes, Navajo, Hopi, on and on. There were people from Central and South America who came up, especially from Brazil, but not only. The organizations like the International Indian Treaty Council was prominent. The Assembly of First Nations in Canada, the World Council of Indigenous Peoples. That organization barely exists anymore. I think it may be gone. Lots of organizations and indigenous groups did this. And altogether, it built a lot of support. What I was really getting at is that you can't just go in there and say, we want a declaration, let's do it. There had to be a lot of other activity going on at the same time. You know, people were putting on receptions. People would dance and do cultural presentations so that people would understand what was going on. Over and over, people thought of innovative ways to build support. One of the things that happened in the 1990s was that we created what's now called the Permanent Forum on Indigenous Issues, the UN Permanent Forum, a group of 16 experts that meets once a year. And again, hundreds of Indigenous peoples come to that two-week meeting to talk to the Permanent Forum about problems they're facing. The Permanent Forum really only has the authority to make recommendations to the Economic and Social Council and to the agencies and offices of the United Nations. But still, it is a very important forum for airing the grievances and problems and issues that confront Indigenous peoples. And that, too, was a part of the total picture of building support for the UN Declaration and for building understanding about Indigenous peoples and for all that we're doing now and that we hope to do. Indigenous peoples were taking part in the negotiations about the Convention on Biological Diversity. There's an Article 8J that deals with the preservation and maintaining of the knowledge, innovations, and practices of Indigenous peoples. Indigenous leaders are taking part, some of them, in the climate change negotiations now. Some took part and are still dealing with the World Intellectual Property Organization. There's almost nothing in the international sphere that some Indigenous leaders are not participating in today. And that's why I say that Indigenous peoples are pretty widely accepted in the world community, even though there's some grumbling about it, and even though there's still far to go to get things changed as they need to be changed. Now, beginning in 2010, the United Nations decided to hold a world conference on Indigenous peoples, and the main goal of it was to find ways to actually put the declaration into effect. In other words, let's make it something more than just good words. What can we do that will make countries actually live up to these promises and commitments and abide by these rules that they agreed to in the declaration? That was the purpose of the World Conference on Indigenous Peoples. That conference took place last year in September 2014, and it did result in a document, an agreement, they call it an outcome document, probably the plainest name I ever heard for an international instrument, an outcome document. But it contains a lot of commitments on the part of the United Nations and on the part of individual states to do things to achieve the objectives of the declaration. And well, what are the objectives of the declaration? Well, I guess you get the idea, to preserve Indigenous peoples, cultures, lands, and so on and so on. A group of tribes in the United States that eventually came to number over 136 tribes formed together. Okay, you've seen this, I just told you about that. At least I didn't read it, did I? The tribes began coming together. The Navajo Nation, that's a Navajo delegate on the left. There's that white-haired guy again in the middle. And this guy Remember the Tihatan case? He's a descendant of the Tihatan Indians, and he's the first vice president of the Tlingit and Haida tribes of Alaska. That's him making a statement in the UN in the preparatory work leading up to the World Conference. He really dislikes the Tihatan case, as you might imagine. This, by the way, is Carla General, the great-granddaughter of Descahe, Levi General. She's now a lawyer for the Indian Law Resource Center. And rather good at it. She's spends nearly all her time working in the UN, kind of making up for what her great-grandfather didn't get done. But the process of preparing for the World Conference and the process of working to get some results went on for a year and a half. A lot of negotiations, a lot of fighting over it, a lot of lobbying of countries. We would go to New York and call up the missions, ask them to meet with us. And we'd go and meet with them, tell them what our recommendations and proposals were, and ask for their support. And they would be stunned, surprised. They said, oh, okay, I think. And they would vote for us in the meetings. So that's literally what's happening. It's still happening. It's going on right now, because here's what the tribes did. We, you know, there was a kind of, okay, what do we want to get out of the World Conference? Four things were decided on. One was to try to find some way that the UN would take action of any kind, some kind, do something about violence against indigenous women. We made some starting recommendations, like, well, appoint a special person to be a reporter about this. They call it a special rapporteur. It's a report. Somebody writes a report. Anyway, lots more needs to be done, though. And so that was one of the main things we wanted to see the World Conference make a commitment to. Another was to create an implementing and monitoring body for the declaration. Now, nearly all human rights instruments, like the Convention Against Torture, well, there's a convention, there's a committee of experts, a committee of independent experts, that watches over what countries do, that watches over that treaty about torture to do everything it can think of to get countries, well, not to torture people, or to call attention to violations when they occur. The Convention on the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women, well, they have an implementing and monitoring body, a committee that, again, promotes compliance with the treaty and watches for violations and so on. We need the same kind of thing for the declaration, a permanent body of experts inside the United Nations that will watch for violations, try to do something about it, that will report on violations, that will do studies, help interpret the declaration, and so on. Yes?
So, I'm a little curious about how the sort of governance structure for Native tribes, say, here in the United States, how that works in terms of a program like this. Like, if there's some issue that the body, you know, if it exists, that the body sees, you know, facing a particular group of indigenous women, for example, sort of who would that recommendation be addressed against? Like, the federal government of the United States, or the specific nation, or?
Yeah, generally speaking, it's the countries that are obligated to respect human rights. Now, to a certain extent, private groups, when they, let's say, murder people or beat up women or what have you, sometimes that problem can be attacked by addressing the failure of the government to adequately police and prosecute. But it's really the national government that has the responsibility for compliance. Now, our implementing body doesn't exist yet, so that, but yes, that's
you need a convention then. more than a declaration, no?
Well, that would be nice, but I don't think we're going to get a convention anytime soon. And there are plenty of declarations about human rights that have implementing mechanisms. Yes. The declarations on decolonization, for example. All the decolonization movement was based on declarations of the General Assembly. And there's a committee on decolonization called the Committee of 24. That's the implementing body for the whole decolonization process. Immensely successful in general. So we don't really have to have a convention. We need an implementing body now. That's what we said. And the World Conference agreed, by the way. But the fourth, what am I up to? No, I'm just up to the third. The third thing was we need a status in the United Nations so that indigenous governments can actually participate permanently in the United Nations in the future. Today, the government of the Navajo Nation has to borrow somebody's credentials, like an NGO, to get in and speak in the Human Rights Council, because they're just an Indian government. It's a government of a nation that's larger, and they have a better government and, you know, more coherent laws than many of the member nations of the UN. But they don't have any actual status that allows them to participate in the UN on a permanent basis. This kind of thing, they do participate, but it's all just because of ad hoc, temporary decisions that say, well, for this meeting, we're going to allow it. So we think, and we proposed, that there should be rules that permit indigenous governments to be accredited to participate in the UN all the time, permanently. And the fourth thing was we wanted the UN to take action to protect sacred sites. We got all four things, I'm happy to say. And now we're in the process. You can read it. This guy's the lieutenant governor of the Chickasaw Nation, head of the National Congress of American Indians. Bunch of people that were at the World Conference, various chiefs and leaders, of, mostly from North America, those. Here's that guy, Will Micklin, the descendant of the Teton Indians. Anyway, let's keep moving. Well, I've told you all this. I need to move more quickly. We got what we said we were asking for, and we're in the process now of getting the United Nations to actually do the things they agreed to do at the World Conference. They have agreed they're going to hold an expert meeting and start talking about how to create the implementing body. That meeting's going to happen in Geneva in early 2016. These things take a while. They'll start creating rules for participation of indigenous governments either late this year or in January or February, and those negotiations will take place in New York. Now, indigenous people will be there participating in those negotiations as well, because we got to see the rules are written right, both for the implementing body and for the participation. For the violence against women, we got the Human Rights Council this past September, a bunch of us, small group, we were over there. At the Human Rights Council meeting, they agreed that they would hold a high-level interactive panel discussion on the causes and consequences of violence against indigenous women. We've already begun work to see that that is something that seeks out serious action that can be taken. We've also submitted action recommendations to the UN Commission on the Status of Women along the same line. So that's where those negotiations are moving along. These are some of the people who have been participating, mostly Alaska Native women. Violence against women in Alaska is just horrendous, unbelievable. Anyway, the permanent forum I've told you about, This is Keith Harper. He's now the U.S. Ambassador to the Human Rights Council. He's Cherokee. And that's Jody Gillette speaking to the Human Rights Council last June. I just told you this information. Let's move on.
Sorry, what's the time frame that you foresee? Is it like a 5-year process to get the implementing body and all that stuff?
No, I think the implementing body might get wrapped up by September of next year. Possibly. Maybe not. If it isn't September of next year, it'll be September of the year after that. For the rules, the UN General Assembly has to do that, and it's going slowly. That could be 2 or 3 years, something like that, but it's not going to be forever.
How about determining which peoples or nations get to have representation at the United Nations?
Well,
determination of who, what?
I think almost certainly the way that's going to be done is there will be a process where an indigenous government or people will submit an application, documentation. Here's who we are. Here's the proof. Here's our authority to be here. And we'd like to be accredited to participate. Blah, blah, blah. And the committee looks at that, makes a decision. That's the way it's done with non-governmental organizations, more or less. And every few years, you have to, you know, show that it's still all true. You know, you have periodic review to make sure everything's still all right. It shouldn't be a big problem, but it, you know how these political things can be. There's sometimes a lot at stake. On Sunday, I go down to Easter Island, also called Rapa Nui. I saw a building just down the way called Rapa Nui. That's the real name for Easter Island. That's a colony of Chile, and the indigenous people there, the Polynesian real people there, are demanding decolonization. They don't want to be a colony of Chile any longer. Chile doesn't like that. You know, there's a lot at stake there for Chile. And sometimes things like that occur where countries get really agitated and oppositional. Let me just say, because I think we're out of time, the Organization of American States, you know, it's a regional intergovernmental body, 35 member nations. It's a lot like the UN, except it's just the Americas. They have been creating a declaration on the rights of indigenous peoples, too. It's a little better than the one in the UN. They've had the time and the interest to try to make some improvements. For example, there's an article on what countries should do in dealing with uncontacted indigenous peoples living in what they call voluntary isolation. It's a tricky question, but important. They have better provisions about protecting indigenous women and families, better provisions on dealing with militarization and what happens in periods of armed conflict that affect indigenous peoples. There are many reasons why the American Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples is needed. In every way, it is above the standard of the UN Declaration. There's general agreement that no part of it should ever fall below the UN standard, because countries have already agreed to that. That set of negotiations is going on in Washington, D.C. It's relatively easy to get there for tribes in the U.S. The negotiations have been authorized for one more year. They'll probably begin again. They're not scheduled yet. They'll probably be once a month, February, March, April, May. That's the way it was this year. It'll probably be that again, or something like that. Again, indigenous peoples from all over the Americas will be there fighting for what's right. And I think we're going to get it. We might finish it up. It'll very likely be finished this year, and if it is, if the negotiations are finished, the General Assembly of the LAS would approve it in June. If it's not this year, well, maybe next year. You get used to that. We're almost out of time, but sorry, I blathered on too long in the beginning, but maybe there are questions.
Well, there are no doubt questions, and I will, take it in the hand of you.
I have a question, but, a few years ago, a leader of the Mohawk people, came out here to visit me and his wife, and I took him to Muir Woods. And there's a big tree sarn grove there. And afterwards I said, Mark, how did you like this beautiful trees? And he said, they're really nice, except it's very sad. And I said, why? And he said, because imagine all the trees that were here, you know, long time ago. And 95% of them are gone. And he said, and now they leave a little patch, you know, for the tourists. He said, well, it's like our people. You know, we had 30 million people in North America, and then they put us on patches called reservations. That being said, the reservations, the Native peoples were declared sovereign. I mean, I'm not sure about all this, but I guess they don't pay taxes. A lot of people go and buy gas and cigarettes to save money because they don't pay taxes. And also, I don't know if this ties with the UN, but they're considered sovereign and the casinos, was that the reason they could create casinos? Because they're not really a part of the U.S.?
Well, no. That's a bit complicated. The law is that tribes can have casinos if states can have casinos. And if the states outlaw casinos and gambling, then the tribes can't have it either. But most states do allow it, therefore the Indians do it. It's a complicated bit of law, but it really doesn't have much to do with the way everything's connected to sovereignty, but it's sort of off our point there. That particular bit isn't take up all our time just to explain casinos, but your points are good ones. Don't believe the thing about don't pay taxes. They don't have to pay some taxes, but they pay a lot of taxes.
I have a question, actually. I'm sorry. I have a question. It has to do with, it's an easy declaration when you're dealing with a minority within a government situation. But I can think of the African situation in which one would say, who are the indigenous people and basically in a government? And when is it, whose government is an indigenous government? In other words, and I could imagine about indigenous rights and the question about indigenous rights. I mean, this works when it's a minority, or, you know, it doesn't have power, or that the power in the state. But when you have states that are integrated with tribes, when you see this with all kinds of conflict in Africa, I mean, this will become difficult, it seems to me, which tribe actually has the rights of self-determination on one thing or another. I mean, the same could be said, for example, when would you, what would be adjudicated in the Hopi-Navajo conflict over land, we'll say? I mean, there were huge things, and sort of federal government decided, or BIA decided on a compromise. But in this declaration, the question is, it's not a challenging thing as much as it's a question, when could you bring something for some adjudication? When would it be reasonable as a government to bring it in? What would that government be constituted as in terms of being indigenous?
Well, there is no adjudication. None of this can go to court. There is no court to take it to. So that's never an issue. It's all about political pressure on governments to abide by the declaration. No possibility of using the declaration to force the government to do it. It's not binding. Now, that's not to say it doesn't have powerful political and moral force. It does. That's what it's about. It's about politics, morality, organizing, and so on. Now, who is indigenous? Interestingly, there is no definition in the declaration, but there has come to be a kind of customary law about who is indigenous, because there are definitions in the International Labor Organization Convention on Indigenous Peoples. There are several definitions out there in writing. The World Bank has one, on and on. What it comes down to is this. The simplest thing to keep in mind, I know it sounds stupid, but this will serve you. It's Indians and people like that. The more a people is like an Indian tribe, the more likely it is that's an indigenous people. If they're not much like an Indian tribe, they may not be indigenous people. Generally speaking, the definitions refer to being a distinct people with continuity dating back to pre-invasion or pre-colonization, yes. And continuing today to be distinct and having historical ties and cultural ties and so on. But there really isn't a formal, strict definition. Countries will be able to decide for themselves who is indigenous and who isn't, much like the U.S. government does in recognizing tribes in the United States. They have some discretion in making those decisions, but not a lot, because, as I say, there's going to be a kind of customary international law about who is, what is the definition of an indigenous people.
I'm just going to let some people who didn't have a chance. Did you have a question?
Yes. I want to ask you, you know, for your long experience with working with on the subject and with Indian people. So my question is, from their point of view and also strategically from a legal point of view, about this tension between equality and the civil rights fights, yes, or the man, and the indigenous and collective rights fight. So first I want to know, from their point of view, what is really important today for people, you know, like to have a better life, to have better economical situation, or to have, or maybe it's not or, it's and, to have this historical recognition, the territorial, territorial control, etc. So, because you see, like in the question of territory, is it better to have this indigenous claim, or perhaps like a civil right issue of property, you know, the individual? So, you understand my question?
But I'm not going to let him answer quite yet, because he's got to go really
quickly.
And I want to get a couple of questions in. So,
where could I watch this?
Go ahead.
I have it on YouTube on our website. We got ISS website. ISS website. Institute for Societal Issues, ISSI.
ISSI.
Yeah.
I think one further to share must be based on
the colors that we have a website. One of the sports in it is called ISSI.
It's true that
SI, right? Institute for Societal Issues.
In addition to what we just talked about, the historical continuity based on the COVID studies done by the UN Working Group, I think.
Yes.
So that's just an add on. And then my question is regarding to the implementing mechanism of FORA, the World Conference. actually Article 24 and 42 actually of the Declaration sort of presented some good groundwork that coming forum could be ideal monitoring or information body. I'm just wondering, during your conference, did that come up? I'm sure it did. You actually decided to go to intervention 2 years ago. I'm wondering if you have to do that.
No, because, well, the permanent forum doesn't have the mandate to do much of anything except to make recommendations to the UN itself.
Yeah, it's what we asked them to invite. We actually asked the General Assembly to amend the permanent forum so that speed up the process.
I see what you mean. Exactly. Well, that could have been done, but they didn't. I don't know. You know, that was not spoken about very much. I'm trying to recall if I remember anything about that. I think the feeling was that the permanent forum needed to stay doing its present job, which is a lot, and that taking on something that substantial would require restructuring the permanent forum a lot. And maybe that was, it might be damaging something that's doing a pretty good job as it is. I'm not sure. That's as much as I can recall. Well, those questions are the kind that cause people to wring their hands and have lots of debates. In general, many people feel that their participation in a particular community that has a distinct culture or set of traditions, often kinship, that participation in such a community is a very important value. And so they want to preserve and protect that. Is that contrary to equality? Well, no, the state isn't discriminating against anyone by permitting that.
No, on the contrary, to bring the combat of the native people to more equality, you see? And not necessarily to focus on indigenous rights, but on equality rights. Because I don't see them treated as equal in this country.
Well, no, they're not. many rights that they should have are being denied. And it's quite right to say that isn't good, that's a bad thing. But what we don't want to do is get in a position of saying to be really equal, we have to destroy the tribes and make all the Indians just Indian individuals. Mm-hmm. Oh, no. You see, that would destroy a good thing trying to achieve another good thing.
And you think you can have both of them?
Yeah, of course, yes.
You can be a discussion because
this has to go somewhere.
Yeah.
It troubles many people and it's complex, but it works out. It isn't insoluble.
There's just one, there was a quick question and you might take it.
What spaces has the UN opened or worked on in preparation for the implementing body? I mean, it's nice that there's going to be an implementing body, but the reality is that what do you implement if the people aren't ready for it? It takes 2 to 3 years. So it's like, what is the UN doing now? Spaces, they're working with governments, local tribes, how are they reaching out? Is there anything?
Well, there's a special rapporteur on the rights of indigenous peoples that goes out and does studies. There's an expert mechanism in the Human Rights Council that does studies at the request of the Human Rights Council. And there's the permanent forum. But it isn't enough. And that's why, in fact, the General Assembly agrees that we need an implementing body. We need something that will be a permanent body that will simply focus on seeing the countries do what they're supposed to do under the Declaration.
Well, join me in thanking